Good evening, everybody. How's everyone doing? In case anybody's wondering who in the world I am, my name's Wendy. I live in Bensalem, PA, and what I'm doing right now is sharing with you things that God has shown me through His Word. And I wanted to share in particular today's vlog. I normally don't get to do one on a Thursday, but I'm getting to do it because of all the interesting, cool things. For the first time in nearly a year, my hubby, Ricky, is actually out right now hitting balls. He was a tennis instructor. And long story short, thanks to a drunk driver, he can't really do that anymore. I think he wants to try to get back into it, like maybe on a part-time basis, but he can't do it the way he used to. So for him to be able to get outside right now is such a blessing. So I wanted to share some things with you that God has been showing me as I started the study. And I wanted to share with you out of Esther chapter 2. This is out of the Time Warp Wife. And I've enclosed a link to the study. It's completely free. Or if you want to go on Amazon.com and buy the study guide, which I have right here, this is it. It's an in-depth Bible study journal, and I'm telling you, it's awesome. Darlene Shachet, S-E-H-A-C-H-T. Darlene is, I tell you, Darlene is a blessing from the Lord for me right now, because she's being one of many people that God is using to help me in my walk with the Lord. And I wanted to share some things out of this chapter that I don't know if I got to share yesterday, because yesterday I was especially summing up as best I could with chapter 1 and even, you know, here with chapter 2 as best I could. I wanted to share some things that God really showed me out of this, and I pray that, you know, you guys will be touched by it and that it will be used of the Lord to encourage you in your walk with the Lord as a woman, as an individual that God has made to serve and honor Him. To kind of sum things up in the background, this is during the days of the Persian Empire. The Israelites, the Jewish people, have been allowed under Cyrus to go back home. And this is quite a few years after Cyrus, where Xerxes, or Ahasuerus, who was the ruler of Persia at this time, he's having a big party. Big, huge party. And during this party, his advisors and all his so-called friends convince him to summon Vashti, who was at that time his wife and the queen. She refuses. End result, she's kicked out of being queen. And they established this decree. And I mentioned this yesterday, that she was not only no longer going to be queen, her whole position, her title, her crown, and everything were given to somebody else. He immediately divorced her because he was so ticked off. And the problem was, this is where pride and arrogance, coupled with a whole lot of booze, can get you in a whole world of trouble. And this is where, in chapter 2, Ahasuerus is realizing his mistake, and he can't undo it because Persian law at that time was completely irreversible. What a shame. That's what you get for, you know, being an idiot. But basically, his advisors, they coerce him a little bit more here to completely forget her by getting some new women. They basically say here, let beautiful young virgins be sought for the king, and let the king appoint officers in all the provinces of his kingdom, that they may gather all the beautiful young virgins to Shushan, the citadel, or the capital city, the palace, into the women's quarters, under the custody of Haggai, the king's eunuch, custodian of the women. Bottom line is, like, that they're like, hey, why don't you hold a beauty pageant? Why don't you hold a contest? Grab all the gorgeous virgin women out there, and you pick, you have your way with them, and pick one to be your queen. Brilliant. That sounds like In today's society, that would be the bachelor. And the key thing here is, these women were chosen whether they wanted to be chosen or not. I've done a few bits of research on this. I have. And especially, I've read a lot of commentaries. One commentary I've read, which was out, which is Joseph Benson's commentary of the Old and New Testaments, it states here, the word that's used here, T-I-L-L-A-K-A-C-H in the Hebrew, is being taken by force. And it, he describes it this way. Hadassah, which was Esther's Hebrew name, before her marriage, and she was called Esther by the king after that, after it. Esther was brought also unto the king's house, or taken, and that by force, as the word telekach often signifies. For so great was the power and tyranny of the Persian kings that they could and did take what persons they liked to their own use. That was part of their whole law. So poor Hadassah is taken. Now, a background on Esther, Hadassah. She was orphaned. Her cousin, Mordecai, brought her in and raised her as his own. And unfortunately had no choice but to allow her to go. It was either that or he loses his life. So here in this situation, you see that in the midst of this horrible circumstance, you see Esther, I firmly believe, choosing to trust the Lord. She chooses to completely place herself in the hands of the Lord, and she chooses to conduct herself in a manner that is honoring to the Lord. And I find how interesting this is, that she chooses to basically be, you know, live as holy a life as possible. She chooses to honor God whatever way possible that she can. And it shows. It shows to other people. If you read further here, that now the young woman pleased him. This is Haggai, the chief person of the women. He's the one in charge of all the women in this whole thing. And I believe in this situation, what occurred here is, if you read in Daniel chapter 1, you see Daniel and his three friends purposing to follow God and not eat the king's meat. I think that she, in her own way, was choosing to do this too. And this brought her into very good favor with Haggai. It says here that she pleased him. I believe that her character, her godly character, shone through to Haggai. And he basically favored her very much, so much so, it says here, and he obtained his favor, and she obtained his favor, so he readily gave beauty preparations to her, besides her allowance. I'm not sure what allowance was, but each of these women were given certain things, and he did this, but plus, he also, it says here, then 7 choice maidservants were provided for her from the king's palace, and he moved her and her maidservants to the best place in the house of the women. That's interesting. That's very interesting, because he saw this godly beauty within her, and he knew there was something special about her. He didn't know what, but he knew, and I think it was the hand of God. I very much see that this was just totally God's hand in this. And I was reminded in this, as I was reading this, because especially they're talking about the beauty treatments, and you want to do some interesting stuff on this. This was basically a total of a year's preparation. There was 6 months of oil and myrrh of aloes, okay? And then there was an additional 6 months of more of other purification treatments. And basically this was, I believe also they were teaching them etiquette, you know, on how to approach the king, being in the palace, etc. And when it was Esther's turn to spend the night with the king, she was given anything she wanted for this encounter. And I think back to, if anybody has ever seen, and I highly recommend it if you haven't, One Night with the King. It's so beautiful, a movie. And it's about Esther. And I think the woman's name that played her in this was Tiffany DuPont. But the guy that played Haggai, the head chamberlain of the women, was played by Tiny Lister. And it was awesome. And I see in this, as Esther's approach in this, how different it was from everyone else, was she was patterning herself. I believe that because she chose to follow God, whatever way possible, I see somebody of humility, gratitude, and graciousness. She presented herself with complete dignity and honor as a godly woman as best she could, totally fit the role not just of queen, but a godly Proverbs 31 woman. That's what I saw. And I also saw in this an example of how we as followers of Christ, we are to live in purity and honor and dignity. It was reminding me of Romans 12 verses 1 and 2 that states, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your minds. I think it says that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable work. I would encourage you to read it. You'll see what I'm talking about. That really got me because I was thinking of that in this particular area. That this woman, she chose to live a life completely honoring God, no matter what. And I applaud her for it. She listened, she did listen to her cousin, because he told her, don't say anything to anybody as to who you really are. And I can understand that. There were so many issues pertaining to how the Jews were being treated. And I understand that he would say this to her. And it's interesting here. I have something in my Bible. It says, how could Esther hide her Jewish heritage and faith? It says, to be holy seed, according to Ezra 9 verse 2, does not guarantee godly actions and attitudes. For Esther or Mordecai to fall short morally or spiritually does not undercut the truthfulness and reliability of Scripture. Through generations, God's people have repeatedly failed to obey him or even consult him and his word, yet ultimately human sin cannot thwart God's plans. Now, I can understand why she did what she did. I really do. But I also see God's hand within this, as this is saying. And I see why he told her this, but she was determined, I think, to still follow the Lord, whatever way possible, to live a godly life. I think she was doing this not just to obey Mordecai, her cousin, but to keep herself safe. Pardon me, that was Isabella. But I really love in this how God had his hand on her, seriously. God completely had his hand on her where she falls into favor with Haggai, the head person here, and he gave her whatever she needed, whatever she wanted. And I believe her attitude was approaching this with humility and courage and dignity as all possible. But I was also reminded of 1 Peter 3, verses 3 and 4, and I want to read this to you. Give a little backdrop in this because you want to understand the situation. Peter is speaking to men and women. He's talking about submission, and he's speaking in this area about the importance of submitting to God, being submissive to God, yes, and our husbands. But he's talking here something very interesting. He's saying, I'm going to go backtrack to verse 1 in chapter 3 of 1 Peter. Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands. Now, that does not mean in any way, shape, or form to allow your husband to trample all over you, to allow him to demean you, debase you, you name it. But he's talking about living a life that shows submissiveness, that shows humbleness. And he goes on to say that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives. When they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear, do not Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. And if you read Proverbs 31, you find what this is talking about, what this very passage is talking about. The virtuous woman. Who can find a virtuous woman for her price is far above rubies? I love this passage because I see so many, you know, interesting, examples to me. Top of which is my mother. But if you read from Proverbs 31 from verses 10 through 31, you'll see what I'm talking about. And this is very interesting because I believe Esther was displaying this. And what I love in this, as I said, is God's still working his will in his way, even with Ahasuerus's advisors still coercing him, again, into further insulting Vashti. They used Persian law against him and her to prevent any reconciliation, but God still had a hand in this. God still worked his will within the situation. But as I said, what really impressed me was the obvious godly character of Esther and how this character, this godliness, was noticed by everyone around her, including Haggai. She could have been bitter, cold, and cynical about her situation. She could have been, you know, look out for number one, but she didn't do that. She chose to trust in and follow God whatever way possible. And she kept, you know, her word in not revealing it until the appropriate time when Mordecai comes to her, which you will find later. But what I see in this is a woman who chose to trust God. And I see a person who, in the midst of a really awful situation, I mean, can you imagine? You're a single young woman. You've never been with a man sexually. And all of a sudden, you're rounded up amongst a bunch of other women. You're saying, oh, congratulations, you're going to be selected for the king's harem. That would have scared the living daylights out of me. I'm telling you, that really would have scared the living crud out of me. But you see how calm, I don't know how else to describe it. She chose, as I said, to trust God, which is amazing for her. And I love, you know, yes, Ahasuerus felt bad for what he did to Vashti, but it was too late. So his servants try to make her forget him, and they kind of succeed. But God gives him Esther, and I love, yes, that initially that, you know, she doesn't reveal who she is yet, because she's honoring Mordecai. It's interesting too in this area. Because it says here, if Mordecai, in a commentary here, if Mordecai sought or desired that his niece, now she really wasn't his niece, it was cousin, should become either the king's concubine or wife, he certainly acted contrary to the Jewish law, which forbid any marriage or communication of that sort with idolaters. But the circumstances of things, and perhaps the hopes he entertained of being able to do his nation great service thereby, may plead his excuse. And I agree. I believe she was forcibly taken, as this commentator suggests. And if you see in this situation, you see that God had a hand in everything. And in the moment she is brought before the king, she was not, according to the whole situation, the women that were taken, the whole process took 4 years. But in the process of this, when it was her time, King Ahasuerus immediately fell in love with her. And how it came to pass, as this commentator says, that it was so long before Esther was advanced to succeed Vashti seems difficult to resolve. But we are to consider that a great deal of time was spent in gathering the virgins together, and that's the truth. And that it was a year after they were collected before she was brought to the king. And besides, he took some time. It is likely to try how he liked her, da-da-da. to try her wit, humor, and conversation. So I think he was getting to, took the time to get to know her, but I believe it was God's hand that he did fall in love with her. And I believe that God would use this, as I said. And if you read further, you also see here, Mordecai gets to sit in the king's gate. I don't know if this was something that he earned as a result of Esther being queen, or if this was beforehand. Pardon me. It says here, possibly this was back before Esther's marriage. Because it says here that, I'm reading also with the commentary, but I encourage you to read this commentary from Benson. You'll see what I'm talking about. And you see here that Esther not just did what Mordecai said, but she kept her word in this area. And she also looked out for Mordecai. That was another thing. She honored Mordecai by making sure he was okay. And you see it even further on. But you also see here that Mordecai, through this, he finds out, God's hand again, that he finds out of a plot against the king. And he relays this to Esther, who relays it to the king. And the end result is these guys get their comeuppance. I really encourage you to read chapter 2 and to see what I'm talking about. But I also encourage all the women out there, everyone out there. You know, this morning I was, with what I was reading out of God's word, you know, how we find ourselves in situations that we're not expecting. We find ourselves in situations that are beyond less than ideal. You know, especially right now for myself, I'm still dealing with the loss of my father. But also, I was thinking of what occurred yesterday in London. I was reminded of what Romans 8 verse 28 states about how God knows what he's doing, that he'll use even an act of evil for his honor and glory. And we need to remember, people, that Satan is a defeated foe. I feel so much right now for all those in London, England, as this was just not just an act of terror, but it was a complete act of evil. And I know that, again, God is still in control, and in the end, God totally wins. I want to say something, too, here. I know that I have some friends here on Facebook, some fellow believers in particular, that were voicing their disgust over what Donald Trump Jr. said. And I want to disagree. He had every right to say what he said. Because if you look carefully at it, this Muslim mayor of London said something pretty nasty about what happened in Chelsea back in 2016. And I think that was nasty, what he said. And I think that Donald Trump Jr. had every right to say what he said. And there have been a lot of people, and I say this, I wonder what this mayor thinks now after this happens. I also wonder as well what he thinks of, there's a picture going around. There is a picture, and it speaks volumes. You see these individuals that are trying to help this wounded individual, but you see this one woman that walks straight by. She's on her phone, and notice very carefully what she is wearing. And I'll tell you right now, that is a person that, even if they weren't wearing Muslim garb, that if they were to do that, was a person that just didn't give a rat's behind about what was going on around them. That really bothered me. But most of all, what bothers me is how people can criticize, how the liberal media can criticize what Trump Jr. said when it was more than perfectly justified. But yet, we have a situation in Maryland where a 14-year-old girl gets raped. And nothing is being said about it, especially in the mainstream media. Nothing is being said about it, especially due to the fact that the offenders, a 17-year-old and an 18-year-old, are both illegal aliens, people. Now, I'm sorry if, you know, you're thinking I'm going off the tangent here, but I've got to speak out on this. And I know that sometimes we find ourselves in situations or things occur where they're not to our liking. You know, that there's something that we completely don't expect. And especially with what happened in London, you see 5 people are dead right now, and that's including the terrorist. But you see that even in the midst of this, I know God's going to bring good through this evil. And I am here to reach out to those who are facing any difficulty, especially to those in London, if maybe you happen to be watching this, to those who have been traumatized in any way, shape, or form, whether it's what happened in London or in any other situation, if you're going through any trial, difficulty, or any awful situation, as I said this morning, you are so not in this alone. I want you to know that God is certainly with you, and He will see you through this. As I said, His ways are past ours of finding out, but He knows what you're going through. He knows what He's doing. He will see you through this, and He will bring you through it in victory. Isaiah 26, verse 3 states, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee." And I pray that you will come to trust and know the God of the impossible, the God that I know, the God that delivers from sin, the God that is a comforter, a healer, of loving kindness. Yes, the same God that hates sin, but he loves you. And he proved it through sending his one and only son, Jesus, to die on the cross for you. And I pray that you will come to know him today. I pray that if you don't know him, you will come to know him today. I'm going to post a link here on how you can come to know Christ as your Savior. But if you want to, why don't we pray right now? Say, "Dear God, I know that I am a sinner. I know that my sin separates me from you, and that I deserve to be separated from you for eternity in hell. I know that you are holy and just, but yet you love me, and you proved it by sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for my sins, and that he did not stay dead, but 3 days later he rose again. And I proclaim with my mouth that I believe that Jesus is your son, that you raised him from the dead. And I choose to accept you right now, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. I ask you to come into my heart and life and cleanse me of my sins. Make me a new creation in you. And I will follow you all the days of my life. Thank you for saving me and making me your child, for redeeming me. Amen." And if you've prayed that or clicked on that link and prayed that, you don't have to pray the exact words, but mean it with all your heart. Then I welcome you into the family of God. Please feel free to get in touch with me. I want to help point you in the right direction if possible. But most of all, I want to encourage you in your walk with the Lord. I encourage you most of all, no matter what you're going through, to keep your heart and mind focused on the Savior, to look full in His wonderful face, and to not let the distractions, to not let what Satan puts against you get to you, but choose to trust him. And I also ask, as I said this morning, please lift up all those who were traumatized by what happened in London yesterday. Pray for the families, especially of those who were killed, but most of all, pray that this nation and most of all this entire world comes back to God. I challenge you all to choose to be like Esther, to choose to trust God in whatever circumstance that you were in, and to let Him be in charge of your life in every situation. I've got to get going, have a whole lot to take care of today, but I wish you all a wonderful evening, and I encourage you to not only follow up with this, but read ahead with Esther chapter 3. And click on this link where you can find the whole Bible study guide. And let's compare notes. I encourage you in that area. And tomorrow, I'm going to see about going live. I think we'll do this between 2 and 4 p.m. Eastern time. So send me a message to see what time's good for you guys. You guys have a wonderful evening. And remember that no matter what, God is in control. Just stay true to Him. Bye for now.